I'm not a heritage worker. I'm a journalist and cultural activist active in Bosnia and Herzegovina for last more than 20 years. But with some strange coincidence, I came in connection with the National Museum of Bosnia and Herzegovina, and it resulted with the Europa Nostra EU Prize for Cultural Heritage, and also Grand Prix that we won in 2016. At the beginning, I would like to give you a context in which we worked. Coming from Bosnia and Herzegovina, as you probably know, this was former Republic of Bosnia of Yugoslavia. We had a brutal war from 92 to 95, and after the war, our constitutional setting was set in Dayton, with Dayton Peace Agreement, and this constitutional setting actually didn't have any provision for culture. It resulted with the fact that we don't have Ministry of Culture on the state level, but the field of culture was extremely decentralized, and state was separated into two entities and 10 cantons. So at the moment, we don't have Ministry of Culture on the state level, but we have 14 ministries of culture on various levels. Our state was often called Frankenstein state, trapped state, locked state. And this situation actually created a very bad time for several institutions of culture which had a national prefix. One of them was, and the biggest of all them, was the National Museum of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Actually, nobody from those 14 ministries of culture ever wanted to take responsibility and funding rights of the National Museum of Bosnia and Herzegovina. So this institution was left in some kind of legal vacuum. They managed to survive for several years through some various project grants, but they are a very big institution. They are built in 1888. It is actually four museums under one roof. They consist of ethnology department, archaeology, natural science department, library, and they have beautiful botanical garden in the middle. That is really one of the most beautiful spots in the city center of Sarajevo. Yesterday in the keynote speeches, we've heard that the biggest problem, the biggest threat for cultural heritage is war, destruction, and looting, but today I will speak about another one. It is indifference. We will see how indifference actually can almost destroy completely cultural heritage and the museums. In the moment when we visited the museum, it was the year of 2014. It was already 2 years as the museum closed for public. As I said, they managed to survive from some various grants, but in the year 2012, it was no longer possible. So the management of the museum decided to close the museum, and they put the bars, as you see, on the main entrance. They set the on, and wrote and write on the bars, zatvoreno, closed. So the audience couldn't enter from the main entrance to the museum. They thought they will create the reaction. They sent dozens of letters to all those ministers I've mentioned earlier. They sent letters to the police, which police station is just across the museum, asking them to come and take over the museum. They thought they will create a shock in the society, but actually nothing happens. Nobody reacted. And in this situation, actually, it stayed for 2 years. At the same time, public opinion about the museum was pretty negative. Workers of the museum have been labeled as lazy as ignorant as people who don't know how to manage projects, who don't know how to open the souvenir shop or restaurant, which will probably save the museum. So actually, it was quite negative publicity about the museum. Some international representatives of international development agencies active in Bosnia and Herzegovina even went even further to call the museum workers criminals who hijacked the museum, and they even called the police to arrest them. So in this situation, actually, my organization, which is a small NGO called AKCIJA, AKCIJA means action in Bosnian, we actually decided to see if we can do anything about this problem. We visited the museum through the back door, through the back entrance, and what we saw, it was December 2014, it was winter, it was very cold outside, but when we entered the museum, we saw a horrible picture. It was extremely cold in the building, no heating, no electricity, and workers were there in their coats, gloves, working. This image was, we didn't expect to see, because we've been really brainwashed by the media and very negative publicity. We thought that actually the only thing we can do about this situation is to tell the story about museum workers. We decided to make a photo portraits of them and to tell their stories through small interviews we recorded. And for that process we needed almost 7 months, because as colleagues earlier mentioned, they've been extremely mistrustful, they've been, they didn't trust anybody, they didn't want to collaborate. But as the time was passing by, they started somehow to create a bond with us, and we managed to make 44 photo portraits and record the stories of the workers. We asked them actually, what is your motivation to come to the work without salary, without social insurance, without health insurance? What do you say to your family when you return without any money? And sick. Even. People were really sick, they couldn't go to hospitals, they've been trying to borrow insurance card from somebody else, but they've been keeping coming and protecting the museum. After 7 months, we decided to open an exhibition of photo portraits in the museum, and we announced this exhibition with a video. And I'm asking the colleague to play that. Says that the museum was closed since 2012 because the government don't want to provide funds for the workers and for the institution. But despite that, workers are coming every day. They are guarding the museums. The museum. We called the exhibition the Guardians of the Museum. What we discovered actually while speaking with the workers was that actually they have been organized themselves in the shifts. They did 8 hours guarding shifts, everyone, from the cleaning lady to the director. They come and guard the museum with their bodies, actually. Their alarm system were collapsing, they didn't have electricity, but they've been protecting the building and the collection every day. What we did actually after this exhibition was that we invited citizens to come to the museum and do the guarding shift inside of the museum. We wanted actually to initiate a citizen solidarity and the solidarity of other cultural organizations in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And actually, we invited people to do dejura. Dejura is a guarding shift. And the response of people were remarkable. We had more than 5,000 citizens coming every day in 45 days action. We actually managed to invite many collectives, sports companies, children, schools. Before that, we deployed a very complex media platform. Our main content were photo portraits and videos that you saw. We built a web page of the campaign called Ja sam Zemaljski muzej, I am the museum. We built all those social media accounts and put photos of the citizens in the guardianships on the Facebook page every day. Very shortly, after 1 week, we had more than 5,000 followers on all media accounts. We also had partnership with print media, radio and TV. We published in the daily newspaper Oslobođenje stories of the workers every day. One of our friends, he's an old art historian, said to us after the campaign, "I never thought that the story about the museum will be the cover story for 30 days in Bosnia and Herzegovina. That was impossible." But our wish was to break this wall of ignorance, of indifference. We wanted that, because it was summer of 2015, we wanted to poke politicians every day during their summer holidays with the stories of the museum, that they cannot actually ignore it. We also organized every day various cultural programs in the museums that have been somehow gifted to us by other cultural institutions. We wanted to say that this is not the problem of the museum. This is our common problem. This is our common interest, and we need to protect it. And the response were really marvelous. This is also support of the business company, shopping mall close to the museum. People hate that shopping mall, but they decided to also support us, giving us this big LED screen to support us. Actually, we moved our office in the museum, wanting to really know what's going on inside of the museum and having legitimacy and authenticity when we speak on behalf of the workers. And actually what happened, after 45 days the museum was opened. Politicians actually took over all credits for the opening of the museum. They had speeches, and they didn't, nobody actually mentioned our campaign. But we actually expected this, and we've been happy anyway. So you see, the bars were removed, children were entered the museum, and the museum is working since 15th of September 2015. Afterwards, actually, we decided to nominate employees of the museum for the Europa Nostra award for the in the category dedicated services. But actually, the jury of the Europa Nostra obviously was very, very smart, and they actually decided and realized that all this job was done with the help of activists, with the help of civil society, with the grassroots initiative. So they actually acknowledged both of us, the museum and AKCIJA and all other activists. So we won Europa Nostra, European Union Award for Cultural Heritage in Madrid, as you see. And a few months later, we organized local ceremony in the museum with Jordi Saval, Plantu, and Sneshkan, of course, our great friend from Europa Nostra, and we also invited citizens to come and take a photo with Europa Nostra award, because that was their award, we thought. This is the common, our joint photograph of citizens and employees in front of the museum. After this action, our NGO decided to continue to work with the museum. We built a web page for the museum, and also activate their social accounts, help them to build the PR for the museum. They also decided to have to start new projects. They are very, very active. They had several exhibitions in the past 2 years, but few days ago they had a press conference marking 2 years of opening of the museum, and they said that they still have the problem. Problem of the museum financing was never systematically solved. They still don't belong to anyone. The legal vacuum is still there, and that they can expect crisis even next year. So actually, this project actually shows one form of public-civic partnership, not public-private partnership, where we demonstrated as a civil society organization that we can help to this bigger cousin museum to somehow activate and communicate their story, that cultural heritage actually has potential to mobilize masses. It has personal stories actually have potential to resonate with our inner spiritual state, and that they can mobilize us. So I think the lessons learned are very, very important, not only for Bosnian context, but for the context of museum work everywhere in Europe and globally. Thank you very much.